Hello, I'm Dr. Ken Berry, a family physician with almost 20 years of clinical experience. And in this video, let's discuss the coronavirus that I'm sure you've heard about in the news, what you should know about this, and what you should do. You've heard about this novel coronavirus on multiple media outlets, and then you've also heard from multiple specialists, virologists, disease control and prevention specialists. And a lot of what they're telling you is worrisome, but they're not really giving you all the practical tips that you need and that you can use to protect yourself and your family. In this video, I'm going to attempt to give you all the information you need to know and then all the steps you need to prepare yourself and your family so that you guys can be protected from this infection, whether it becomes more virulent and more worrisome, or whether it peters out and dies. If you enjoy videos about medicine and nutrition, then take a second and click that subscribe button and the little bell right beside it so that every time I get a bright idea, you'll be one of the very first people to know. So first, I'm gonna tell you everything you need to know about this novel coronavirus. And then at the end of this video, I'm gonna tell you the steps you can take to protect yourself and to protect your family from this infection or any infection, and then you can share this information with the people you love to protect them as well. This coronavirus that you've been hearing about in the news is a virus. It is an enveloped virus, and that'll become important later in this video. It's a very large RNA virus. There are numerous coronaviruses that we know about and that have been cataloged, but this one is special, and we'll talk about that in a bit. Most coronaviruses exist in animals, and there have been multiple coronaviruses that have been documented to spread from animal to human. But most coronaviruses end there. There's very little, if any, spread from human to human. That's what makes this virus different. It started in China in 2019, and in early 2020, it has been confirmed that this virus does spread from human to human. Another thing you need to know about coronaviruses in general is that they can mutate very quickly, and this can make them much more virulent, which is the fear and the worry. It can also make them less virulent as well. Only time will tell what's going to happen with this novel coronavirus. The symptoms of coronaviruses in humans are typically a cold, an upper respiratory infection, a flu-like illness, a bronchitis. They're typically not worrisome or dangerous at all, except to the very young, the very old, and the very sick. As I make this video in early 2020 in January, it's still too early to tell just how virulent this strain of coronavirus is, and that's why I'm making this video, so that you can be prepared for the worst as you hope for the best. Now, here are some key points about coronavirus that you need to be acutely aware of. This doesn't apply to every virus, but it does apply to many viruses. So first and foremost, the coronavirus can infect a person and that person have absolutely no symptoms and no fever for 2 to 5 days. They are contagious during this period and can infect other people, but they have no symptoms and they have no fever. When this coronavirus is spread by coughing or sneezing, the tiny droplets of saliva or mucus can actually transmit this virus up to 5 to 7 feet away. So you don't have to be right up against someone or giving them a hug or a kiss to catch this virus from them. This coronavirus is contained in an envelope, which protects it from the environment. And so if someone coughs or sneezes, or touches their eye, nose, or mouth, and then touches a surface like a countertop or a doorknob or a seat back, the virus can stay there dormant but yet alive for up to 5 days. This is another thing that makes this particular type of virus very dangerous and very hard to control the spread. Another key fact about this type of virus is that you see people in Asia wearing masks, and that's probably good. That probably does control the spread and protect them a little from infection. But this virus can infect any of your mucous membranes. So that includes your eyes, your nose, your mouth, your genital region, and your anal region. Any of these are susceptible to this coronavirus. It appears that the most dangerous place you can be in an outbreak like this, whether it becomes a pandemic or not, is a closed environment with a closed atmosphere. So a bus, a train, an airplane, a large meeting of people, whether that's a public meeting or whether that's church, clinics and hospitals, all these places where there are lots of people in very close proximity with a closed atmosphere. So you're not outside in a pasture or walking on the street. These environments tend to magnify the danger of a virus like this. Currently, there is no test for this coronavirus. There is no vaccine to prevent it, and there is no medication to treat it. If you do develop this virus and go to a clinic or hospital, all the healthcare provider can do is give you supportive care, and we'll talk about that later in this video. As I said earlier, you can be infected and you can be contagious with this coronavirus for up to 5 days and have no symptoms or no fever whatsoever. So currently in airports, they are screening people with thermography, which basically is checking them to see if they have a fever. But you don't have to necessarily have a fever with this virus to be contagious. In healthy teenagers up until about 50 or 60 years of age, this coronavirus is likely to give you symptoms of a severe cold, a severe respiratory infection, even a severe influenza type infection. But the danger is in the very young, the very old, and the very sick, or people with conditions that suppress or derange their immune system, this can lead to much more serious infections and even death. Both Middle East respiratory syndrome and severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS and MERS, which you may have heard about in the news a few years back, they're both coronaviruses. Now, we don't know the virulence of this current novel coronavirus strain, but in those strains, they were virulent enough to spread from human to human, and they were severe enough to kill people, but they weren't virulent enough to become a pandemic that the entire world should be worried about. I don't want you to worry about this virus. I don't want you to panic about this virus, but I do want you to be concerned. I want you to be vigilant, and I want you to be prepared. At the end of this video, I'm going to give you steps, very easy, simple to implement steps that you can use to protect yourself and your family. Now, first, I want to give you a scenario, an example of how you could become infected, even though you feel like you're doing a lot of things right. So let's say you're in a public place. You maybe went to the store or you went to work and you come in contact with a person who was infected 2 days ago. They still have no symptoms. They have no fever. They still feel fine. They sneeze in your presence from dust or from some pollen in the environment, not from the coronavirus infection. And you're standing 5 feet away from them. You have just become infected because some of the viral particles landed in your eye. Maybe you were even wearing a mask and thought you were protected, but you weren't wearing wraparound protective glasses, and therefore it got in your eye. You're now infected with the coronavirus. Some of the saliva droplets landed on a door handle, and 2 days later, someone else touches that door handle to go to the restroom, and then they touch their eye, their nose, or their mouth. They are now infected with this coronavirus. Even though they haven't been within 100 yards of the infected person, they touched a surface that had the coronavirus on it. And as I said earlier, it can live on surfaces like that for up to 5 days. So now you're infected with this novel coronavirus. You get on a bus to head home. Even though you feel great and you have no fever, you infect multiple people on that bus ride home because you coughed a little bit because you were drinking something and got a little choked. The saliva droplets are spreading all over this closed environment. And people who are not even sitting near you, can be infected. And then the next load of people that get on the bus will touch the seat where you were sitting. They will also be infected, even though they've never even met you. Now, you finally arrive home, you take off your mask, you're still feeling fine, no fever, no symptoms, and you proceed to infect your entire family, even though you don't even know you have this virus yet. Now, that scenario sounds scary, but again, I don't want you to panic. I don't want you to be worried. I want you to be concerned and vigilant, and I want you to get prepared in case this does become a very virulent coronavirus that develops into a pandemic. So now let's talk about what you should do to prepare yourself and prepare your family in case this does become a problem. First and foremost is stay home. Stay away from crowded areas. Stay away from people in general. Only stay around your immediate family. This is the ultimate protection. And this is something I feel like the specialists that you're seeing on mainstream media right now, they're just not talking about this. If this does get worse, you need to stay home. Number two, while you're at home, you need to discourage and deny visitors. As long as you keep your door closed and there's no possible way that virus particles riding on saliva or mucus microparticles can get to your family, you guys are safe. And so you can sit home and you can order DoorDash and you can order stuff off Amazon and not be compromised, as long as you're using the universal precautions of wearing gloves, wearing a mask, and wearing the wraparound eye goggles anytime you go outside your home. Now, let's say you have to go to work. Your profession is something that is vital to the proper function of society, or you just have no choice. You have to go outside and you have to be around other people. What should you do? Number three, you absolutely should wear a mask, but not just any mask will do. You need an N95 or a K2 quality mask. These are considered medical masks. I put a link down in the show notes below to a mask like this. Not that you necessarily need to buy that, but I want you to be aware in case the World Health Organization or the Centers for Disease Control do upgrade this to pandemic status. You need to know which kind of mask to wear because some don't really protect you at all. Number four, you need wraparound safety glasses. You see people in Asia wearing the mask, and that's good, but if your eyes aren't protected, your eyes are a mucous membrane, and you can contract this coronavirus just from a tiny invisible particle of saliva that contains the virus landing on your conjunctiva or the surface of your eye. And so wraparound glasses are a necessity if you go into public. Number five is some kind of latex-free medical disposable glove. You can buy these. They're very cheap. You can buy them in bulk. I put a link down for the glasses and the gloves down below just in case. But you absolutely should wear gloves when you're in public because even if you're wearing your glasses and your mask and you touch a surface that has the coronavirus on it, you're going to take that back home on your hands. And remember, it can live on the counter, doorknob, toilet seat, whatever, for up to 5 days. And so you definitely need to wear the gloves when you're out in public and then take them off before you go into your home. Number five is to wash your hands very, very often, and definitely wash your hands with warm water and soap if you touch any surface out in public or you come into contact with anyone who sneezes, coughs, or is in any way in close proximity to you. You don't know if they're infected or not. They may be in the prodromal stage that has no symptoms and no fever. And then also additionally, don't trust antibacterial hand sanitizers. Very often these will kill bacteria, but they don't kill all bacteria, but many of them don't kill viruses at all. And so you cannot trust them with your safety in case this coronavirus becomes a pandemic. Next is to try as much as is humanly possible to avoid any crowds, any closed-in area, any form of mass transit like planes, trains, cars with, if you're not the only occupant, Ubers, anything like that, where there's another human with you in a closed space, you can't tell if they're infected or not. And so best to avoid that if at all possible. Finally, you should avoid clinics and hospitals unless you work there and your job is vital to the public safety. Or if you are a patient, you should only go to the clinics and the hospitals if you have a life-threatening illness, infection, or injury. You don't want to go because, and here's why, say you start to come down with cold or flu-like symptoms, is it coronavirus or is it not? You don't know because currently there's no test that can tell the difference. Your doctor has no medicine that they can give you either in the clinic or the hospital to protect you or help you get better faster. So what if you came down with just the regular cold virus and then you go to the clinic or hospital thinking it's the coronavirus? You don't have that, but you catch it while you're there. Also, the clinics and hospitals, if this does develop into a pandemic status viral infection, they're going to be overrun with sick people, and it's probably going to take hours for you to be seen, and they may not be able to help you anyway. So only go to a healthcare provider if you have a life-threatening injury, illness, or infection that you just cannot treat at home. Hopefully, this outbreak of this novel coronavirus will be contained and will never develop pandemic status. But again, I'm going to say I don't want you to worry. I don't want you to panic or freak out, but I do want you to be knowledgeable. I want you to be alert and vigilant, and I want you to be prepared just in case the worst happens. Please share the information I've given you in this video with everyone you care about. Only by sharing this information will we possibly be able to prevent this from becoming a pandemic and prevent this from becoming a disaster for humanity. Both the World Health Organization and the Centers for Disease Control are very good at managing these sorts of outbreaks, these kind of infections, and this possible pandemic. Watch their websites for future updates. And this is what they were created for, is just this type of thing. Now, neither of these organizations is perfect, but they are by far and away the best we've got to combat such a novel coronavirus. Please consider subscribing to this channel for future updates. I'm Dr. Barry. I'll see you next time.